Europe is known for its food. You've got flaky croissants in France, pastéis de nata in Portugal, and pretzels the size of your head in Germany. It's a paradise for carb lovers, but risks lurk around every adorable corner cafe for celiacs, people who can't properly absorb the gluteny goodness in breadstuffs. Except, if you spend a little time scrolling on TikTok, you might hear that European gluten is just built different. Plenty of people online say that when they eat gluten in the US, it makes them feel bloated, brain foggy, or just generally terrible. But when they head to Europe and load up on bread and pasta, it's smooth sailing. No symptoms, no problems, just Wiener Schnitzel and good vibes. It's a compelling idea, especially if you're someone who's been avoiding gluten and dreaming of an excuse to fly to Paris for pain au chocolat. But before you start planning your best baguettes of France tour, you need to know the different reasons some people steer clear of gluten and what scientists say about European gluten. So grab a pizza or a gluten-free pizza and settle in for the answers. If you're trying to avoid gluten, first you have to know what gluten even is, which is more complicated than it sounds, because gluten isn't one thing. It's a whole group of proteins found in wheat, barley, and rye, and it's kind of a star in the baking world. It gives these types of foods their chewiness, stretch, and moisture, and recreating that texture without gluten is not easy. That's why gluten-free breads are often dense, crumbly, and taste like they've lost a fight with a sandbox, which makes it almost unfathomable that many people choose to forgo it. But often, there's a good reason. Like celiac disease, an autoimmune condition where the body mistakes gluten proteins for dangerous foreign invaders and launches an attack that damages your own tissues in the process. This attack happens in your small intestine, which is normally covered in a shag carpet-like mat of tiny projections called villi. These villi massively increase the surface area of your small intestine so that you can soak up all the nutrients your body needs from your food. But when you have celiac disease, it's like someone took a lawnmower to your shag carpet. The villi get flattened and your nutrient absorption can take a nosedive. That can lead to vitamin and mineral deficiencies, but it can also cause all sorts of unpleasant gastrointestinal symptoms, which is why, for people with celiac disease, a breadcrumb isn't just a crumb. It's more like throwing a rock at a beehive inside your body. The good news for more than half of you is that celiac disease is genetic. So if you are part of the 60% of the population that doesn't have the genes for it, you can't develop it. And even if you do have the genes, that doesn't guarantee you will get it. Scientists know there's also an environmental component, but they're still figuring out exactly what that is. Where the research stands today, we don't entirely know what causes one person to develop celiac while someone else doesn't. Contrary to what you might see on the very much not peer-reviewed news source TikTok, the environmental component is not just living in the US. Some of the highest known rates of celiac disease are actually in European countries, like Finland and Sweden. Celiac disease is one reason you might have to go gluten-free. But there's also its itchy cousin, the gluten-related autoimmune condition called dermatitis herpetiformis. It causes a blistery, scaly rash in response to gluten, and it shows up in about 10 to 25% of people with celiac. Some folks can have the rash without the unpleasant gut symptoms of celiac disease, but often the gut is still being damaged. So those are some pretty good reasons to avoid gluten. But celiac disease and its related conditions are not the only medical reasons people don't eat gluten. There's also gluten ataxia, an even less common autoimmune reaction to gluten that affects the brain instead of the gut or skin. It can damage your cerebellum and cause coordination problems. So less, I feel a little off after pasta, and more like, this spaghetti has me feeling like I just got off a merry-go-round that was going way too fast. These three autoimmune conditions are very serious, and as of right now, pretty much the only way to manage them is to eat a completely gluten-free diet. And unfortunately for these folks, there's nothing anyone, even in Europe, can do to make gluten safe. So if that is you, please do not eat gluten in Europe. No matter how many influencers say they did. After all, if an influencer jumped off a bridge, you know what? They do that sometimes. Just don't deviate from what your doctor tells you if you have a literal autoimmune reason to avoid gluten. But maybe your immune system isn't going through an identity crisis, confusing totally harmless gluten for deadly pathogens. Maybe your immune system is just throwing a hissy fit, the full-on allergy kind, like what happens with a peanut allergy, but this time with wheat. While wheat is one of the most common dietary allergens, it's still quite rare for your body to treat it that way, with wheat allergies affecting less than 1% of adults. Many people with wheat allergies are allergic to gluten, but that isn't always the case. You can be allergic to other proteins in wheat instead. If your allergy is to a component other than gluten, you might be able to eat non-wheat grains, like rye or barley. They have gluten, but That's not your problem. All you care about is whether or not it has your specific doomsday allergen. So in many cases, foods that are okay to eat with a wheat allergy aren't an exact match for foods that are gluten-free. But avoiding gluten is usually a fairly safe bet that you're also avoiding wheat. Whether gluten or wheat is the culprit, all the reasons for gluten avoidance so far have been pretty clear-cut immune responses, but not every reaction fits neatly into those boxes. And that brings us to the murkiest medical reason you might not eat some of the tastiest stuff on Earth: non-celiac gluten sensitivity. This one's the most common among a lot of populations, but also the most controversial. It's kind of a catch-all diagnosis for people who feel off after eating gluten, but don't test positive for celiac or wheat allergy. The million-dollar question is, what is actually happening? So in blinded studies where participants don't know whether they're eating gluten or not, some people can reliably match up when they have symptoms to when they've eaten gluten, but most people can't. That suggests that while some cases of non-celiac gluten sensitivity are totally valid, others might just be blaming gluten for crimes it didn't commit. A true diagnosis should involve feeling better on a gluten-free diet, and then having symptoms come back when gluten is reintroduced. But most cases are self-diagnosed, and not many people are lining up to do a controlled gluten challenge, especially when they think gluten is the thing making them feel crummy. Even this isn't just a US phenomenon. People react poorly to gluten all over the world. But some US travelers swear they feel fine eating in Europe, so let's break down what might actually be going on. But before that, all science needs funding, even the videos we make to talk about science. So here's an ad.
Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video. Brilliant is an interactive online learning platform that moves at your pace. If the only time you get to yourself in the day is that extra long bathroom break, we get it. You've got a lot going on in your life. That's why Brilliant's short lessons are made to fit into your schedule. Each one can be completed in a matter of minutes. And it's all online. You can achieve your learning goals on your phone, so you can take advantage of that one corner of peace and quiet in your home, office, or wherever you find yourself. To try Brilliant for free, visit brilliant.org/scishow, scan the QR code on screen, or click on the link in the video description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription.
First, giant flashing neon disclaimer. If you have celiac disease or a wheat allergy, this does not apply to you. No matter how fresh the focaccia, your immune system won't get the memo that it's on vacation. But for everyone else, let's explore some possible reasons that people think European gluten is better. The first theory that you may have seen in your travel inspo deep dive on TikTok is that travel itself changes a lot of things. You're probably sleeping more, walking more, eating more slowly, and stressing less when you're on vacation. And all of those things can help with better digestion and less gut inflammation. That might help you feel better overall, but there's no evidence that those chill vibes or extra steps help you specifically digest gluten more effectively. In fact, if you have a wheat allergy but consume wheat, exercising immediately after eating can make things worse, potentially even leading to anaphylaxis. And if your symptoms are the result of an autoimmune condition, maybe a lower stress level makes them feel a little less severe, but they're not going away. So vacation vibes might make you feel a bit better, but they aren't the panacea for gluten woes. One of the other theories out there is that it's the wheat itself that is different in Europe. And this is true to some extent. There are different types of wheat, and they vary in their protein content. And since gluten is the primary protein in wheat, that means they vary in their gluten content too. Hard wheat, which is grown more often in the US, has more protein and more gluten than soft wheat, which is more commonly grown in Europe. And the environment where wheat is grown, things like temperature, rainfall, and drought, can also impact the amount of gluten it produces. So in theory, a loaf of bread made from soft wheat grown in France might have less gluten than one made from hard wheat grown in North Dakota. But, and this is a big but, wheat is a global commodity. Grains and flour are shipped all over the world. So just because you're in Paris doesn't mean your croissant came from 100% French wheat. It could be American wheat in a Parisian disguise. And again, if you're dealing with an immune issue like celiac or wheat allergy, the wheat source doesn't matter. Your body's gonna launch a fight against an American foe or French foe with the same vigor. So this might be more of a consideration for people with non-celiac gluten sensitivity. But it's also possible that you could be eating American wheat in France and still feel better than if you were eating it in the US, just because you think it's European. Yes, gluten placebos are real, and their evil twins, gluten nocebos, are too. In a 2023 publication, people who were expecting to eat gluten experienced worse symptoms than those who ate the same amount of gluten but weren't expecting to. Even just the idea of gluten can make perceived symptoms worse. That's a nocebo effect. So if you're on vacation and you believe the gluten is better in Europe, that belief might actually lead to fewer symptoms, a placebo effect in action. Which is kind of wild, but hey, whatever works. Again, only if it works. This only applies to folks with sensitivities. Celiac disease won't placebo away. Now, if you're watching this video before your European adventure, we might have burst your placebo bubble a bit. But there's still a chance that a controversial chemical would make a difference for you. I'm talking about the pesticide, glyphosate. Glyphosate is the active ingredient in the original recipe for Roundup, which is used to kill weeds and, in some cases, to dry out wheat crops before harvest. This use of glyphosate is way higher in the US than in Europe. Glyphosate is not good for human cells in a lot of ways, and while the main pathway it targets for plant killing is specific to plants, so humans don't have it, a lot of bacteria do, including the ones living in your gut. So the theory goes, exposure to glyphosate might mess with your gut microbiome, which then can disrupt the delicate balance of microbes in your gut and cause inflammation or other symptoms. Glyphosate has been shown to cause changes in the gut microbiome of a whole bunch of animals, including mice, rats, honeybees, and even earthworms. And in mice, researchers have been able to make the connection between glyphosate exposure, changes in gut microbes, and increases in gut inflammation. But before we get ahead of ourselves, this is not human data. It suggests that similar things could very well be happening in your gut microbiome, but we just don't know for sure yet how it works in people. It's an active area of research, and it's entirely possible that glyphosate exposure could be a piece of the gluten-free pie for some people. But these differences may also be stemming from the way that wheat is processed. The way wheat is turned into bread or pasta can make a huge difference in how people respond to it. One factor here is fermentation time. Traditional sourdough and other long fermentation breads take a while for yeast and bacteria to break down sugars, including a group called fructans. If those fructans aren't fermented in the bread, they can be fermented in your gut, turning your intestines into a tiny bioreactor with some unpleasant byproducts. People might assume these symptoms are due to gluten, when the gluten is just an innocent bystander. European bread tends to have longer fermentation times, while the US has leaned towards speedier production, so you might end up with fewer gastro problems in Europe. And in reality, European bread might be easier to digest for some people, but not because of the gluten. It's the sugars. Which means, if your immune system just hates gluten specifically, longer fermentation won't help. Your taste buds and your gut microbes might love sourdough, but your immune system will still say, absolutely not. So if you find yourself happily eating a crepe in France, but not in Pittsburgh, gluten might not be entirely to blame. The real magic could be in the fermentation, lower levels of glyphosate, or maybe just your steadfast belief that everything is better in Europe. But if you have a wheat allergy or an autoimmune reaction to gluten, like celiac disease, whatever you find in Europe will treat your body the same way as the stuff in the US. Which means you're stuck with the gluten-free options, even in Europe. But rumor has it, that food's also better than what we offer here in the US. So on second thought, maybe I will book that European trip.